welcome back to my channel. My name is Brittany Simon. In today's podcast, we're finally going to cover Trisha Paytas in relation to my philosophy system called The Levels. It's just a system I created with my co-author to kind of observe people's introspection level. So we're not judging Trisha as like a person. We're only gay judging here. So we're going to go through a little bit of her recent content. And we're also going to compare her to a couple of other content creators I've noticed who have similar patterns to her. So if you guys are unaware of the Trisha Paytas like controversy and who is Trisha Paytas, I have videos that I have already created on her, links down below for those videos. With that said, before we get started, I am drinking a tea today. I am drinking my hibiscus tea, which I got my witch box the other day. You guys know I have only ever worked with a few sponsors, and I worked with this really amazing sponsor, and they just kind of changed how I saw witchiness in a lot of ways, because it's just so brandable right now, and people are just so focused on making it a very capitalistic, like, I'm a witch and I read tarot and I'm so cool.
Happiness spell. So I do want, we can do another happiness. Write this down if you guys want. I do not protect my spells there for everybody. Happiness spell. What's our intention? I'm gonna write the intention. Probably pretty self-explanatory, right? To be happy, to be purely happy, where it doesn't involve any material things, to be purely happy. Happiness upon me before this night. Okay. I give whoever cast the spell to know thy happiness I've known so well, where nothing matters and everything's right, happiness upon me before this night. If I'm blessed to have happiness to keep, I'll continue the flow with a smile before I sleep. So every night when you get the happiness, now your job is to keep it flowing, to smile. And you can even just say before you go to sleep, like, I hope everyone can achieve this happiness. And the thing is, everyone can. No matter the circumstances or situation, everyone can. So we're going to put a little happy face. We're going to do a heart here, little stars here, do a little cloud. And we do a little swirly here. I'm going to sign my initials here. So, writing some spells. We can continue some in a little bit. But, yeah, I have a really big spell book, too. I have one, like, this big. So, like, those are a little longer. And those have more, like, teas and different baths you can draw for to help elevate it. Just like crystals, you know, using the elements always. Well, TikTok cat. Cool. What's up?
So in my High Priestess box, I had gotten this hibiscus tea. I showed it back when I first worked with the sponsor, and I'm not technically working with them today. I'm just drinking their tea. So I thought I would mention them, but it's Black Leaves Australian Tea. This is hibiscus, and it's 100% hibiscus. Now, it's a little bit, you know, hibiscus, it's a little bitter. So what I actually did was I cooled it down, put it in my Sailor Moon cup, and I put some ice in there and a little bit of sugar. I almost never use sugar, but with a hibiscus tea, I always feel like the bitterness is even more than a black tea, though, because I'm Iraqi or Middle Eastern or Chaldean, however you want to say it. Avi, like, we grew up with black tea that's super bitter, but yet that black tea isn't as bitter as like a hibiscus to me. So just my little like way of drinking it in a nice chilly way. Also, as winter comes about, I don't know what is wrong with me, but I love cold drinks. I love smoothies in the winter. So that's just kind of my vibe today. All right. With that said, I do want to talk about Trisha, and I want to talk about the ways we can observe somebody who's such a train wreck and still not really judge them. Because to be honest, Trisha's not the worst I've ever met or seen. To be honest, I've met plenty of worse people, and I think that allows me to see her with a lot more leniency considering her background. Oh my God, that's so good. Okay. I'm gonna drink that all if I don't stop myself. So recently Trisha got married, which is very great. We love that. We're in celebration of happiness. And she's on the path of having, or going down the path of trying to conceive a child.
Doing our first test. Fertility treatment. I'm getting a little sidetracked because I'm a little nervous to be talking about this topic today. First and foremost, if you are going to be leaving any negativity on a person's fertility journey or whatever, then you're kind of just a shitty person to begin with if you wish ill will on someone who's trying to conceive or something. You're just like a really, really bad person, first and foremost. You're just a shitty person, especially when it comes to someone else's body.
And having said that, I know a lot of people will be like, well, you're a shitty person to church. And it's like, you know what? I'm trying to change. I'm trying my best. And that's all I can do. And if you are the type of person who won't allow people to change, then you're just as bad as those people who refuse to change. Because that's how we as humans evolve.
So many of you guys have a lot of strong opinions about Trisha. I have a lot of strong opinions about how people decide to exist. But again, we're only gay judging. So let's gay judge Trisha Paytas and officially put her on where I think she lands on the introspective levels. So a few things I want to point out. Trisha had her big fight with Ethan about 6+ months ago, right? I told you I'd give her about 6 months to kind of like figure her stuff out to see where she lands.
Two.
Hey, it's Frenemies. We're back.
We're back. I get to kill you today.
Why? Work on Frenemies. They're my employees.
Okay, but when I said that to you originally, you said, oh, we pay the employees. They could be working on other things. So why don't we have Frenemies employees and I get input if we're spending 5% of the budget towards them?
I think that's not what it is.
That's if what
I
you said.
So then that's, but, I don't okay, remember,
to say,
but that's
gaslighting
not what it
is telling someone how they feel and you're telling me how I feel and I'm telling you I don't feel frustrated or upset. So I don't know what else that could be. How am I gaslighting you by telling you I'm not feeling this way? How is that gaslighting you? I'm not feeling this way.
Okay.
I wouldn't show up. I wouldn't come here. I would, you know,
Listen, you can be upset and not
have
be because there's a, but you could be upset and then also not be like, I'm not showing up. Fuck you.
I'm
like,
not
there's
upset.
Levels.
If okay. I was upset, I
well,
wouldn't show up.
I'm just explaining.
Up.
I'm just, because you can be upset and still show
but
up.
But I'm not upset. And that's
okay.
what gaslighting
right.
is. Because you're
okay.
saying, I'm gaslighting
I'm
you
gaslighting
by saying.
You. You're not upset. You're perfectly,
oh, wow.
you're in a perfect condition right now.
Okay. Wow. Holy cow. That's crazy. I mean, I don't know how you, I just don't see what you just did. That's really
what
crazy.
Did I do?
We have to end it now. Like, really.
What did I do?
We got to stop for real. Really.
Okay.
Me stop. Please. Please. Okay.
Whenever you're ready, you
All
can
right.
walk away.
So. No, because I don't want to title this.
It's Trisha. The pizza curse.
So can we just like,
I'm
edit
not
going to
title it
it's
Trisha's
not. Right.
thing. It's the pizza curse. It is.
Mm-hmm.
We shouldn't have got pizza. The pizza? Oh no, it was pizza. Trisha, let me just say,
the
I'm
fact,
sorry.
Ethan, that you just did that, you're right. You're
well, I don't
right.
Know what
Nothing's
I just
wrong
said.
With you. That's, but I go, you don't know how much therapy I go to a week. I go to four
but
Zoom
Trisha,
sessions a week.
No, I understand.
Ethan,
but, okay,
Ethan, what you
right.
just said was, you're right, Trisha, everything's fine. That's insane. Like the fact that you did that to me is like
it's
insane.
It's not insane. We're friends.
That was
We're
so
having
nice.
A friendly conversation. I don't have to. I shouldn't have to walk on eggshells around everything
okay.
I say.
All right, Ethan, I'm asking to end this. I'm asking.
You can leave anytime, Trisha.
But then you're making this thing where we're not ending the show, and you get to sit here and be like, "Okay, well, that just happened," and you're eating pizza, and then
I will
joke
end the
whatever.
Show the minute you walk.
All right,
off the
so
prayer.
let's just end it, please. Thank you guys for watching, and I don't want it to be a thing where you're just sitting here eating pizza and you become
okay.
a meme.
So then I'll say I'm sorry.
Okay.
Obviously, I don't want to get in an argument over
I really
like
need
your
to leave.
Okay. All right, we're done. Thank okay. you guys.
Thank you. Can we have Ela as a guest on our podcast?
No.
Why? Because people think like I hate her or she doesn't like me or something. Like I feel like we need to have like, because like, you know what I mean? Like I like Ela so
she
much.
She could sit in. Yeah, she could probably sit in.
You just said no. Now you're like,
oh, yeah. Just a snap judgment. She's busy. Don't talk about Ela. We're cutting this part out. She doesn't want to be talked about.
Are you fucking serious?
I'm serious. We have to cut this.
That's fucking crazy. Like, what's even the point? She's the one we talked about.
Because she doesn't like that you're always bringing her up and saying how she doesn't like you and all this shit because it's not true and she finds it annoying because she doesn't want people to start thinking that, like, she doesn't actually like you.
Well, she doesn't.
Well,
she doesn't.
Well, whatever. Just cut it out, Dan. I'm serious.
I'll talk about it in mine. I don't care because that's so bullshit. I'm going to stop talking about my personal life altogether then, too.
Okay, whatever.
And then turn the H3 podcast and boring and it'll just go down the tubes and no one will care because you guys are not honest and open about shit. So you cut everything out that's personal. It's like, whatever. Wow, you can't even like mention her.
We mentioned her last episode. Because you every okay, you know what? Leave it in.
No.
Every time
No, don't.
You
I don't
go,
care.
Why does Ela hate me? And she's like, I don't hate her. It's super annoying. Why does she keep saying that?
Then
and
why
it's
doesn't
causing
she text me. Like just text,
text
me.
Text you.
Be like, hey, I don't hate you. You know what I mean? Like, but when she's like telling stuff about Moses,
because I always
knows,
say
I don't care.
Moses said, what happened? You know, this is the literal meme where you walk in with the pizza and the room's on fire. This is the literal meme where you come back with the pizza. Oh my God.
I just left to get pizza.
This is literally she's really upset because she was saying how Ela doesn't like her.
Ela says, don't talk about me on the podcast. All I said was you should have the guest. He's like, we can't mention Ela. She doesn't want me to talk about, she's too good for a fucking podcast. Even though we were talked about, they never once consulted me at the beginning of spring. She has a fucking podcast. I brought life to the fucking H3 channel, but Ela's too fucking good to even mention her name. I said nothing bad. I said like, we should have her as a guest or whatever like that. Don't even mention Ela. She doesn't want me talked about. Fucking.
Okay.
I literally don't care. Literally, I don't want to come back because I really fucking hate her.
So she always making comments about the family and how...
I wasn't! That wasn't it! I said, Ela should be on the podcast. And you're like, don't fucking mention Ela. She's the one I'm talking about. Oh, a fucking queen. You guys can talk about my shit all the time, but her, don't fucking mention her name. Dumb fucking bitch.
Okay.
I think we should just end it, honestly.
Yeah, I think so, too.
Such a fucking bitch.
She's not.
And you are too. And you're a fucking cuck.
You
have no fucking backbone.
All right. You should leave. We'll talk later. Yeah, you should get out.
I am going, but yeah. I'm not talking later. Fucking bitch, you too. I don't care. Fucking dumping. I couldn't care less. Your family's
not. It's not about dumping. I don't know what happened.
And Trisha from... how we used to know her as the crying woman on a kitchen floor has transformed her life.
Oh my God. Oh my God. I don't know what to do. He slapped me. I'm being dramatic. This is the only place with lighting.
And so like now like reading all this stuff and like this is why like I don't like to read this stuff because I'm like, wow, people really worry about literally everything. Everything. It's like... it's crazy, but you know what? It gets to be the point where it's like, okay, like, you know, you're just like canceled for everything. You're just like, okay, is there, whenever something like actual real that you need to be held accountable, like no one's gonna like listen. I don't know, y'all. I've always been a spender. I've always been an earner. I've always paid my bills. I've always done all that stuff like that. And if people are genuinely worried and it's genuinely out of love and concern because they love me or whatever, then this is my address to you. It's like, we are fine, and I'm always responsible when it comes to stuff. I do spend probably way more than I should. I probably should have 10 in my houses right now, but like, it's okay. I spend things on experiences. I'm not driven solely by money when I do my music videos. It's not like if I don't make it back, they're into it. If I don't make it back, I'm not like, I don't expect to make it back. None of that's to make it back. I employ other people. I make memories for myself. I make my dreams come true. I get to have everybody with me, my family, my sister, Moses, my mom, all the people I've worked for since 2015. It's a beautiful thing for me. It's what I look forward to. It's my purpose. I have 5 music videos planned for the next year. We have vacations coming up. And I don't know. It's just... but again, I'm going to just do law of assumption and assume that this is coming out of love. So therefore, I'm responding in love. Thank you for the concern. I hope this eases your mind. Truly, sincerely, I hope it does. And you guys want to see, like, this is our guest room. And I come in here sometimes. Well, obviously, they're working and stuff right now. But this is my little spiritual thing. You have chosen to remember. This is my new book that I've been loving. The Secret, which I'm pretty much done with. But I'm going to reread it because I love that book so much. Ask and It's Given, Bhagavad Gita, Joel Osteen. I have all my journals over there. So, yeah, I love this book. I think it's so pretty. This one's a little harder to understand, but it has some good messages in it. I'm going to go. I hope you guys enjoyed Hanukkah vlog again. And happy Hanukkah night 2. We will be vlogging. Today's present is books. As if I need more books. But I am excited because Moses is really excited about his books. My gift for Moses was hard. It was hard to find books because he doesn't read.
I don't think that really can be argued. I think it is clear that Trisha has become a better person. But the disadvantage of becoming a better person is that you lose the person you were in the past, which could be the reason, and in Trisha's case it is, that she got famous. So Trisha owes a lot to that really disgruntled, fucked up girl that she was on that kitchen floor. And at the same time, in order for her to be a better person and move forward, she has to actually go for it 100% or do the thing she's doing now, which is being lukewarm. So we saw that Trisha and Ethan had their moment together on Frenemies, a real moment where she got triggered in, I believe, a medical way. And Ethan didn't know how to handle it, but tried his best. And I think they both hurt each other unintentionally. And I think they both hurt each other intentionally. I think much like Trisha, Ethan is in the same grouping of introspection, but lands a little higher functioning in a lot of ways. And higher functioning I'm using as a loose term here because I am not a therapist and I'm not a medical professional. I'm just a person who reads a lot of books and likes philosophy and likes the idea of introspection and trying to ponder what it means to exist. So I'm watching Trisha and Ethan, right? I'm like observing them as people, and I can't help but love them because I do think there's so much like genuine energy coming from both of them, but I think they're also really dumb. And I don't mean dumb like in a like a, I'm insulting them way, but I mean quite literally in a way that would give me an ability to be more lenient on them. I think smart people that do deceiving things frustrate me more because they're actually planning them out, but Trisha and Ethan are just not that smart. Like, I'm going to be real with you. Sometimes I see Ethan and Trisha try to be that smart, but it never quite works out. And I think I even see that now after the frenemies debacle and the way that it went, the way that like they dragged the family involved, the way that Moses and Trisha didn't even have Ethan and Ella at their wedding, everything that just kind of occurred around that situation in regards to their family, I think proved to me that no one in the situation knew how to handle it properly or had ever had something like this happen. Coming from a very dramatic Middle Eastern family, we have had lots of family fallouts. We've had a lot of fights, a lot of gossip, a lot of infighting. When I came out, it like tore the family apart. But at the same time, over years, we all kind of just like understood that some people are weird, some people lie, some people have trauma, some people are narcs, some people have borderline, and then we just move kind of past it because family's family. Now, with that said, that doesn't mean just because they're family that you need to hang out with them all the time. I most certainly don't hang out with my first cousin that spread a rumor about me after it came out, right? Like, I don't hang out with her. But if I see her at family gatherings, I usually say, hi, how are you? I hope you're well. I hope your family's well. Because I do. I genuinely think she's disturbed, and so I give her a lot of leniency. Versus, I think other people who are acting out of turn, it's either their dumbness or their mental illness that allows me to give them leniency as well. I want to use a couple of examples so I can like solidify this in your mind of how I'm thinking about it. So when I see Trisha and I see her act out and I know she's triggered, I have a lot of sympathy and empathy for her as a person who has borderline, as a person who suffered for 20 years from a mental illness that finally went into recovery this last couple years. I'll tell you, like, the person I was when I'm sick or the person I am when I'm sick is just like a completely different version of myself. And I believe that with Trisha. I don't think when Trisha is triggered, she's her most authentic self. I think when people are triggered, they are their most petty, low self. I think when you're triggered, your body wants to protect you, your mind. So it like disassociates and tries to protect you through the crisis. And it makes it so you lash out on people in ways you don't even mean, which is why Trisha will often post really dramatic videos and then disappear from the internet.
You know, I was reading the comments, the members only one went up, and a lot of people were upset by my little episode yesterday, and I usually wake up the next morning feeling like regret for the way I acted. But I realized this morning that like I, and then last night, of course, I talked to Ethan, and you know, he was saying the crew was really upset with me. I hope this didn't come across. I feel like it did, and I feel like I'm just stupid, but I feel like I need to put this out there because I just like, I feel stupid. I feel stupid, but at the same time, like, I just feel like this is the best decision. So I'm sorry. I don't know where this is coming from. I mean, you know where it's coming from. I got, you know, it's upsetting. It's like losing something that like I really felt like was such a good thing.
So you can tell, medical problem, check, move that aside. Now, I want to give you two examples of people who are similarly really bad at understanding social situations that might not be medical or might be. The first one that comes to mind is actually the Island Boys. You know, they were on Logan Paul's Impulsive, and I do watch Logan Paul's Impulsive.
Boys, what if it doesn't work out? And now you just got this hair and these face tats.
But we had this before. People been saying this before I was a bum. And
well, how old are you? 20?
20 years old.
When I was a bum. High school? What are you talking about?
No. When I was 18 years old, I just started not too long ago. When I was 18 years old, living in the middle of Palm Beach in the ghetto, and people doubted me. It was worse back then. It wasn't even people telling me, what if it doesn't work out? People just fucking walking away from me.
Do you think they're still doubting you?
Man, people, it's always.
We proved a lot wrong.
I proved people wrong. I proved a lot of people wrong. But now there's going to be a whole new wave of people that just came in and wanted, you know, want me to prove.
By the way, we're the only ones in Palm Beach County that got permanent Johnny Dang teeth in Palm Beach.
You should hit up Guinness Book of World Records.
Yes. They might take that one.
Something like that.
I had them up.
I think if, God forbid, it doesn't go in your guys' direction, for real, I think you guys take all of your jewelry assets and invest it in something. So you guys will never, ever be broke again. So I don't think there's ever going to be a broke situation. But I'm saying, like, if you guys...
Jewelry, it can't be worth that much, man. I don't think you're going to flip that into a retirement.
No, you could definitely flip their jewelry into a down payment or something, sure.
One, let me tell you something. George, stop talking. We have multiple.
Wait, that was. Yeah. Hey, that was for you guys.
It. Yeah, you
that wasn't like a hate shot.
I don't need financial advice when I probably make more money than you.
But that was me being nice. It wasn't me being like an asshole. I could be an asshole. I could turn it up and be an asshole.
Why don't you go talk to somebody else about that? It's not gonna go in your favor. But look,
no, it could go in my favor.
Like, you really don't want to go there, bro.
I could go there because I was giving you guys nice advice and you guys are being assholes.
Hey, George, keep talking. I'm walk out.
I'm right here, you guys.
Okay. So what are you trying to say?
I'm just saying. You guys are throwing a lot of threats. I'm sitting right here.
No one's threatening you.
You guys said it's not going to go my way.
Yeah.
This is not the Nilk Boys. We don't do fake over here.
Yeah. What are you trying to scare me or something? I'm not scared of you, homie.
All right. I'm not scared of you guys either.
Okay, so just keep it like that. Feel me?
I'm gonna step in for a second. Hold on. No, hold on. No.
This is a podcast.
No.
Here, I'm moving for you. I was giving you nice advice, bro.
I agree with that.
Did I say anything mean?
You fucked up, George. Our first guest to walk.
You dumbass.
I said if it doesn't work out.
Look what you've done. You upset the island boys.
I said if it didn't
work
out.
Should we take a pause for a second?
If it doesn't work out for my career, I have backups.
You don't have to walk out. I'm down to talk, but does this guy have to be in there?
Yo, what did I say that offended you guys
so
much?
I think it was a miscommunication.
I want to know. No. Before you come back, I want to know what you thought was wrong.
I want to know how much you're worth, because you're worth.
No, we don't have to do
what
that.
What does it have to do with
work? No, I think.
What does it have to do with work?
Because you said sell jewelry and be broke, and that makes no sense.
What the fuck are you saying? No, I said if, God forbid, it doesn't work out, who are you? Who's this guy?
All right, hold on.
What are you trying to show
let's,
off?
Let's
I'm not showing off. I said, God forbid, which means an accident. Hey, bro, God forbid, a situation would happen.
You know who I am, bro? You know me from Island Boys, but you know I'm thugging, bro, right? You know that, right?
Why don't we just let cooler heads prevail? Why don't we just let cooler heads prevail? You know how to do that.
I told you, end it already. You haven't ended it. You keep on talking about it.
But you just said right now.
It's probably because the cameras are still on. Yeah, I already told you.
You're trying to show up, bro. We're not going alone.
Okay, explain to me what I said.
Okay, George, because I was fucking with you in the beginning.
Bro, I never stopped fucking with you guys.
Okay, but George, leave it alone.
Leave what alone?
Leave it alone.
Guys. I don't know if y'all are serious, but...
I'm not...
We're done.
Okay, appreciate it. Thank you.
But you guys were good. Thank you for coming.
No, actually, that was fantastic.
No, you guys were really good.
Appreciate y'all.
Cool. What the fuck? Did I say something that really bothered people?
No.
Because if you had a career and I said, God forbid, it doesn't work, you could take your...
Hold up. It was my question.
Your assets.
You were just building off it. I asked him. I said, boys, it doesn't work.
I said the same thing to you about your Pokemon cards.
Hold up a second. I can't even worry about this for one more second. Guys, we have another guest coming on momentarily. His name is...
No. Well, hold on. Doug, I just think...
Wait, I'm sorry, you did absolutely nothing wrong.
You said they could roll their jewelry into an investment that could set them up for a lifetime.
Dick, bro. What the fuck?
Wait, stop tripping.
No,
I just
not.
Don't like that
don't
shit,
even,
bro.
Don't even trip for one second.
Georgie, can I
ask you something? When you play stupid games, you win stupid prizes. And by ask you something, I mean tell you something.
I don't like threats, though.
Do you want to know what the
what
fuck?
How did you think... All of that was gonna end, George.
Well,
was there a better ending?
Hug me and misunderstood. You actually were giving me great advice.
Do you want to know what the most fucked up thing about all this is for the viewers at home?
They're gonna make it and
no
make
one,
fuckloads
no
of money.
No one was more excited about the Island Boys than George.
Dude, if you guys read my text,
when we told George the Island Boys were coming in, he was sending voicemails, screaming in excitement and happiness about how pumped up he was to sit with these boys.
Bro,
and honestly,
got into the part that I sing their song, Island, I actually like it. What the fuck just happened?
Nah, that just, yo, it's all on video. Everybody's going to realize immediately that was just twisted up and all fucked up. I
said shut the fuck up. What am I going to say to that?
Hold up.
Nah, you were...
Boys, what are we talking about? Island Boys.
No. It's a shtick. The whole thing's a fucking shtick, Georgie.
Well, I seen
the kid go from calm to like, he very clearly was like, now I want problems and smoke.
No, but that part wasn't a shtick.
The reason they're doing so well is because they do shit like that.
Oh, they get
no,
into, like,
bro, they're on their shit. They're on their dog. They're making a moment. Look, they just walked off impulsive. That's cool. Guess who continues talking about them? Everyone else.
Well, I'm just very sad.
How did you
to see them?
This is why I'm saying. That's sad. That upsets me.
I was so sad, bro. That was the first time I ever was excited to meet somebody and they were fucking pieces of shit in real life.
And one of the things that surprised me was that they were two C's, in my opinion. People who grew up in a really small bubble, people who grew up really poor and undereducated, and people who struggled a lot in life, but they had dreams and goals. They knew enough about how to, like, go viral or use the internet to their advantage, but that's where their intellect stops. So when you're a YouTuber, like me, when you're a content creator, when you want people's attention, or in my case, you know, a certain amount of attention, you are usually strategic in how you gain or mitigate that attention. The Island Boys Go on Impulsive's podcast, and George, who's, hello, George, fellow Assyrian, what's up? Like, we're basically like cousins, what's up? So he's on this podcast, and he's trying to give them, like, brotherly advice. You know, what if this doesn't work out? What's your plan B? And the Island Boys got really upset. They got upset that the boys on Logan Paul's podcast was telling them not to burn bridges. They were upset that they were being questioned. They were upset that they weren't getting the credit they deserved. But I need to just, like, hit this home for people. When you're a YouTuber, you know that the longevity of your career is dependent on consistent watch time. And I know these boys are musicians, they're not YouTubers, but it's the same fucking thing. If you're a public figure, attention is what keeps you in the mix. It's what gives you the credit that people want you to have in order to give you the props for being good at your job. So the Island Boys felt like, because they had done this amazing thing coming from this really small place, I think in Florida, and then moving out and going to LA, going to all these boxing events, going to, you know, getting press, they felt like they had made it. But ironically enough, there's always a point in a person's career in which they get enough fame that they could ride it until retirement. But most people, because they don't have the educational background fiscally, financially, they usually make really poor decisions with their money, right? What's the infamous story about Mike Tyson is that he's made millions of dollars, lost millions of dollars. Football players, people who just don't understand how to actually, like, use and utilize money. And then on top of that, they really felt like they were in the right. These, like, boys threw a tantrum on Impulsive and walked out. Showed up to an event later, which I think was the Jake Paul boxing match, if I'm not mistaken. And when they were there, they were getting booed. They had to have security. And I kept thinking to them, Habibis, you're so fucking small. You're a big fish in a small pond, so you think you're able to play with the big boys now. But that's not what's happening. What's happening is that you don't have the introspection to understand where you are in this hierarchy. And so that's the problem that I'm seeing. If you don't know where you are in the hierarchy, you're not going to understand how to move forward. Now, I think the Island Boys are a great example of 2C thinkers who made the mistake of burning bridges, not because of a mental illness, but because of ego. They are a big fish in a very small pond. And so in their heads, they have reached a point of fame where they can't lose it now. But I would argue that they're not quite as famous as they think they are, nor are they quite as secure. And they haven't secured the bag in the way they think they might have. Now, I could be wrong. Maybe they've put their money in investments. Maybe they have money tucked away. Maybe they have, like, you know, some sort of an account that gives them interest over time that they're not touching. It just doesn't seem to be the common pathway for most of these people who get famous very quickly. But they did say that they've invested a lot of time in this career. So I'm surprised that two boys who came from nothing, who both dropped out of high school, who had this really big dream of being famous, didn't think not to burn bridges with the people who could connect them and move them further. I mean, they had a chance on Logan Paul's podcast, which is enough eye time, like enough people's eyes on you, that it could really move you forward. Now I see them on TikTok all the time live. And they're always, like, arguing with people, and, like, their retorts are very shallow. But I don't think they have a mental illness. I think they're literally just dumb. And they're not dumb in a way that makes me want to judge them. I mean, given their background and everything they came from, major props to becoming famous in any capacity. But also, if you follow an algorithm, most people can gain this fame. What's the one of the things I've said even about my own channel is that I purposely try not to become too famous or famous at all, because I don't want a life where I can't go to Walmart without people recognizing me. I think that is, like, for my mental health, that's too much. But I like having, like, a small corner of the internet that I exist in because it's safer to me. I like privacy. I like going out and just being not Brittany Simon, right? I just like being Brittany on the public world. And it feels really good to me when I can do that. For these boys, they have to walk around with security. So the consequence of fame is this. We see this with Trisha when she drives around and goes to, like, fast food restaurants with, like, her pink fucking car. And she has moments where she feels like people are going to follow her. Like, remember that infamous clip she had where guys got behind her and then she just took off driving? Now, half of her paranoia is real, because she's famous and rich. Half of her paranoia, I also think, is outrageously, like, mental illness, obviously. Now, paranoia is very interesting because I have paranoia in relation to my borderline that's in relation to being trapped or like kidnapped or taken, or my stalker gives me anxiety. But then I remember like, oh, I'm super safe. I've done everything I need to. No one's going to like kidnap me. I've already been assaulted and moved through it. Like I'm thinking about all of my own mental health because I'm not trying to dehumanize Trisha's journey by being like, I'm so mentally stable. I could never. It's more like, hey, I think I've been close to making really bad decisions in my life that would have landed me in a position of not knowing why I was doing what I was doing. So when I look at Trisha and I see that she's trying, guys, she has like all these books on her floor and she's reading all these really fucking 2A written books for 2Cs. Like, and when I say this on my observational levels, I mean like 2Cs are the, like everyone else, 2s are everybody. They all live in bubbles, die in bubbles, grow in bubbles. But 2Cs are the least functioning. They're the people who fall for the scams, the pyramid schemes. Not that 2Bs don't, but 2As more, or 2Cs more, sorry, 2Cs more. So 2Cs also fall for the Joel Osteens and like all these other people. Like she loves The Secret. The book alone is about manifestation in such a shallow capitalistic way. It's basically useless. I remember I read it at like 19 and I haven't read it since, but I just remember reading it and saying like, what the fuck? This is not helpful. Like Trisha is not reading, she doesn't have the reading comprehension level to read the books that would help her. So you always have to start somewhere. So start slow. I've read all the like crazy books. I've read The Secret. I've read all these like, 2C books, but eventually you graduate, right? I started reading college level books when I was like in high school and then I moved forward with that. Now you can just like, you eventually can just read like straight academia books or you can read like, you know, just your reading comprehension level is going to be key in your introspective like path. That's what I'm trying to say, girl. So if Trisha's watching this, like no shade, girl, keep reading, keep doing it. You're going to find your way towards that path if you keep reading. Reading is so key, right? But something she said in one of her videos really shocked me. She said, Moses doesn't read. And I was like, Moses, the philosopher, doesn't read? No wonder his philosophy, I think, is bullshit, because he has a philosophy system of we're water, we're all water. I've reviewed Moses in the past. I'll link it down below. But it really frustrates me, Moses's philosophy, because it doesn't make sense and he's not saying anything and the man doesn't read. See, I don't trust philosophers that don't read. I don't trust anybody who claims they understand life or are introspective and they don't read. If you don't read, how introspective can you be? If you don't experience life, how introspective can you be? If you don't question the why, like, girl, your introspection level is not going to be that deep. You're going to think it's deep because you're a big fish in a small pond, but like, let me take you out of that pond and throw you into someone else's pond and you're going to realize how much you don't know and how much you believe you do know. So Trisha, in relation to like, observing her against like somebody else who's like kind of like crazy, is I've been following the Destiny Anna drama, not too much. Like I just started watching Destiny a while back because one of my viewers like told me about him and was like, you're gonna like him. I think he's like a 3, blah, blah, blah. So I've been watching Destiny on and off. And I really appreciate how transparent that Steven tries to be. But his relationship with Anna is like very complicated for me and layered because he thinks she is borderline. I think she's a narcissist. But the reason I say this is key factors. Anna will have conversations in which she, in like within a 15, 20 second like conversation, can change. She'll say one statement, contradict it with another statement, and not see it as lying.
Shit, when even my therapist is like, don't listen to that. Thanks, Steven.
Why would you listen to your therapist when she tells you not to listen to that, but you don't listen to her when she tells you not to stream?
You're trying to convince me that I'm a compulsive liar and that I just lie. What else do you think I lie about? I would love to know. It's because they have multiple, if there's multiple reasons behind something.
You lied about the condom thing.
No, I didn't.
You lied about why you hosted Autistic Destiny.
Okay, I didn't lie about that. Mm-hmm.
Why do you, why are you abusing Merle
really
so much?
Did I say the word pressure? Are you sure I said that word?
You did. Why
did
are
you,
listen
to the clip?
What?
Wait, can you send the clip?
You can listen to the whole thing if you want. Here you go.
Okay, thanks. Hold on,
let me know when you're ready to play it. We'll start at the same time. Ready?
I was gonna just listen to it on my end.
Well, let's just both listen to it. Why not? Ready?
Okay, go ahead.
3, 2, 1, go.
But like, this isn't fair because he's the one that was like pressuring me to not use a condom. It's like he kept on going on about like, oh no, blah, blah, blah. Actually, like, you don't need to wear a condom. This is why, like, you don't, like, condoms are like, and like, we literally argued about this. Like, this isn't fair. Like, I was trying to convince him that wearing a condom is the only way to have safe sex, and he was, like, arguing back and stuff.
So, frills.
So, it's not like I don't use condoms. But he's making it sound...
Anna.
Okay, yeah, I shouldn't have said pressured.
No, it's not just pressured. The characterization of your whole statement makes me sound like a fucking rapist. And you don't even believe the stuff you were saying here.
No, I do. I still felt like you were weird, very especially weird about condoms.
I wasn't weird at all. I literally explicitly said that we could do whatever you're comfortable with. Like, I explicitly typed that sentence out. How is that weird?
Because you're always going on about how it's not necessary to, like...
First of all, I wasn't even...
And you just go to the doctor to take a pill and, like...
Anna, that wasn't even a...
Some STDs are permanent and for life.
Anna, first of all, some of the STDs that are permanent aren't protected by condoms. That was the whole point of that conversation, firstly. Secondly, this is a conversation I was having with Stream, not with you. You were the one that DM'd me to get into an argument about something I was talking about on stream. I didn't just bring...
I thought it was really irresponsible that you, like, basically talk about how you, it's like you don't really need to, like, use condoms all the time.
That's great, but now we're shifting the goalposts. You can think that it was irresponsible. That's fine. But I wasn't trying to argue with you about it. And I didn't tell you that you had to act a certain way. And I wasn't trying to pressure you towards using one or not using one.
Every time we've talked about condoms, you're weird about condoms, though.
I'm not. I'm incredibly straightforward. I just don't like the way they feel. That's it. But if somebody really wants me to use one, I'll use one. I'm a big boy. I'm an adult. It's not weird at all.
I don't know. I guess I think it's kind of weird.
But you said you yourself don't use them. How is that weird?
Yeah, oh yeah, I like that too, how you were manipulative with, like, leaking those DMs.
I wasn't manipulative, Anna.
Yeah, it was manipulative because I was talking about in the context of a long-term relationship. I don't always use them because, yeah, you know, when you're in a monogamous, committed relationship for a long time, you don't always use a condom, yeah. That's what I was talking about. And you presented it in a manipulative way to try and be like, oh, look, she's a liar.
Why would that make you a hypocrite to not use condoms in a long-term relationship?
Because if I'm always saying, like, you should always use a condom, and then, like, you know, I'm not...
So you,
like,
tell people they should always use condoms even in long-term monogamous relationships?
Well, no, I mean, I just say that people should always...
You're lying right now. Do you understand that you're lying right now?
Okay, how am I lying?
Because you're trying to tell me... that you tell people that they should use condoms all the time, even in long-term relationships. And when you were talking about not using condoms, you only meant in the context of a long-term relationship.
Yeah, absolutely.
But that's not the case, because you literally said you're content to be a hypocrite, which means that you're not talking about long-term relationships, because who would tell you that you have to use a condom all the time for, like, your husband and wife?
It was literally in the context of a long-term relationship, though. That's where that's what I was thinking about. And that's why I was pissed at you, that you made it seem like it wasn't. I mean, that's what I meant by, like, I'm sometimes a hypocrite.
Okay. You're lying. but I don't know how else to...
It's because you don't believe
me. Let's see. No, it's because you're clearly lying.
Huge narc sign to me. Narcissists actually have this thing that happens in their brain where they get temporary amnesia after telling a lie because they don't have a consistent sense of identity. This is a relation to Trisha. Trisha has this overlap as well, but I think Trisha's probably more borderline than she is narcissist, though she's high in the narcissistic scale. So I think, like, the way we have to examine people is to be aware that there's a medical issue or there's an ego issue. So with the Island Boys, ego issue. With Anna, I think there's a mental health issue. With Trisha, I think there's ego and mental health issue. I don't think Anna has enough of a presence anywhere in her life to have the ego that Trisha does. But Trisha, like the Island Boys, came from nothing and made something of herself. Obviously has handled abuse. Obviously has been assaulted. Obviously has extreme trauma. The dilemma with Trisha is that she doesn't understand, much like Anna, much like other people, much like the Island Boys, is that when you have this many layers to your life. You need to do a lot more work to heal from it, and it's not easy. It's actually really difficult. So what they end up doing, 2C thinkers, much like Ethan, is like they do this thing where they figure out the problem, they say the problem out loud, and then that feels like recovery to them. Ethan, in relation to his eating issues, will say like, I know I'm fat, I'm just gonna be fat, like I know I'm fat, like he knows the issue, but he doesn't really do anything to fix it. He says he does, and maybe it's partially medication, maybe it's partially getting a workout buddy, a trainer. That's what it's called, a trainer. He could get a trainer. He could do a lot of things, right? And I'm not going to I don't know these people. They could be doing it and not telling the internet. Maybe they don't tell the internet because it's more interesting for views to have the drama of like, I can't believe Ethan's still not getting a trainer. Do you get what I'm saying? As a YouTuber, I can't know what people are really doing behind closed doors unless I knew them. But I'm going to give the benefit of the doubt to everyone I'm talking about. I'm going to give the benefit of the doubt to the Island Boys. I'm going to give it to Trisha, Anna, and I'm going to give it to Ethan. I'm going to say Anna, I'm giving her the benefit of the doubt that she's actually just like a narcissist and crazy. And she doesn't know how to regulate her emotions or her lies. And so she like goes into the spiral of back and forth with Steven. Okay, ding. Ethan's made so much for himself and he feels really accomplished and he has some self-loathing issues and he's working on it and he's trying his best to like figure out what his values are, but he's still kind of loosey-goosey. Okay. Trisha is dealing with like mental health, presence on the internet, bad childhood, growing up confused, literally like a whole bunch of things. And then the Island Boys, of course, their educational level, their trauma, growing up the way they did. I mean, we really have to remember that people are going through things. And if you're like me, who grew up in a middle class home, lower middle class home with immigrant parents, you had different struggles. You had the struggles of expectation of like being rich or like being really successful or doing something godly oriented because, you know, my family's Catholic, or you have the pressures of not being gay, which brought on my borderline. Like my borderline is literally basically a thing because I grew up in a religious home that was anti-gay. And that's like really hard for people to process. It's really hard for my parents to process. It's hard for people to even believe it. But the truth of the matter is like, yeah, when you're 8 or 9 or 7 years old and you're processing your own abandonment because of your queerness, of course it's going to cause like an identity issue and an issue with reality and what's the point of existing and suicidal ideations. Everything makes sense if you really start to tear it apart. Think of your life as a cobweb and start to take apart the strands. I know it's really hard and it's really sticky and they're going to break and they're really sensitive. But if you slowly start to take apart your life, you'll really start to see the humanity in yourself and therefore the humanity in the world. One of the constant struggles I see with Trisha's identity crisis is that she's trying to help the world but cannot help herself. She's trying to help herself, cannot help the world. You have to be able to settle into your own body, your own skin, and radically accept yourself before you can, I think, radically accept the world. Or in conjunction, let's say you're going on a path, and you're going on a path and you're like, I'm going to further like myself. And then you're like, I'm going to save the world. Maybe like this, huh? Maybe like this. Because the truth is, even as you're going along and trying to save the world, you really can't, because no one can save anyone. We have to let people make their own choices. We have to let Trisha make her choices and Ethan make his choices. And we have to let Eugenia Cooney and all these other crazy people make their choices, because everyone's a little crazy on a spectrum. But some people are like almost not crazy. I think of my farm brother, and I always ask him, I was like, what's it like being born into the perfect bubble? And he's like, it's great. I was like, what's it like not having mental illness? He's like, it's great. And I was like, that's crazy, bro. Like he's experiencing existence, or like he's never had anxiety or depression. And I just like, that's amazing to me. And I love that for him. But he was also born into the perfect reality for his beliefs. He's born into a perfect Catholic bubble. He's 6 feet and blonde hair and blue eyes. Even though he's Middle Eastern, he looks like, white acceptable. He has a beautiful wife and 3 kids and a lovely farm. And he's met amazing people along his life. And he's also put a lot of good into the world. My brother might have low empathy, but he has extremely high sympathy and reliability. He's there for you no matter what. He's there for me. Like if I'm having a bad mental health day, which again, hasn't really happened in a really long time. But if I'm having like, if I ever in the past had a bad day, I would just call him and be like, I am crying. And he's like, who hurt you? Who do I have to beat up? And he's like, who is it? And it's like, oh, you know, blah, 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 blah. I got triggered, blah, 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 blah. And like, it really helps, because then after he comforts me, he'll say, okay, suck it up now. And I'm like, ugh. And it's like, that's like my little brother. I don't know if Trisha or Anna or Island Boys, they really have people they can trust who are better equipped at handling them when they are not stable. So I think that's the issue, is like, I look at my life and I think of all the struggles I've endured and how a bunch of people are like, wow, I can't believe you survived that. But in comparison to Trisha's life or Anna's life or anything where your brain is literally your enemy 24/7, like my borderline was never that bad. Like, my borderline was bad, but I was considered higher functioning on the borderline level because I could hold down a job and I could pay my bills. And I was a risk taker for sure. And I have, like, most of the criteria for borderline. But at the same time, I was right away diagnosed as higher functioning. I just have an education level and a curiosity that puts me ahead of the race. That is the reason I believe people stay stagnant. I don't, and I think it ultimately is your, like, fault, in the sense that it is your responsibility, in the sense that you have free will, so you can make a decision to be better, but you have to. Now, let's swing back to how Trisha getting better is scary, because I have also been there. You think about recovery and you think about how happy you'll be, but since you're in trauma, you can't actually know that. So it feels like a fairy tale, like, oh, please, this is never going to happen. Plus, if you Google borderline, everyone and their mom says borderlines are unhealable, awful, the worst people. So of course you're going to feel even less inclined to try to save yourself because you think you can't. But I'm telling you, with DBT and the right amount of books, the right amount of interactions, and the right amount of stability, I do believe in recovery. And not just because I did it, but because I've seen many people around me do it. And I think it has to start with the person's belief in themselves that they can get better. Even though the world is telling you you can't, you have to know you can get better by doing the work and seeing the results. And it's going to be long and hard and tedious and expensive. And it's going to feel like you're going to die. But you know what, bitch? If you have borderline and you've been depressed like I have and you have suicidal ideations, like, girl, we always want to die. So let's get you to a point where you don't want to die anymore. You know what I mean? One of the things that I see pretty frequently is people are worried that Moses is a narcissist. Now, we're not therapists. We can't be diagnosing people on the internet. But I will tell you this. I get a very codependent feeling from the relationship between Moses and Trisha. I also understand that Moses himself is dealing with family trauma he's talked about. He's on the spectrum. He feels rejected and not at home with his family. And that's because his family are mostly 2B thinkers. So his family, Ela's family, from what I understand about them, appear to be 2B thinkers. They're well aware of, like, social faux pas. They're super aware of, like, you're doing the weird thing on the internet. Why are you, like, promoting this philosophy of water? Like, what does this mean? And I think a lot of people, when they see their family and friends going down a path of, like, what are you doing? Even my own siblings, like, my sister will say, like, are you running a cult? And I'm like, are you running a cult? Like, I was like, no. Just because, like, I sit on internet and I'm a YouTuber and I talk about philosophy does not mean you're running a cult. But to make sure I never run a cult on accident, I have things in line that I do that make sure I'm always able to be open to criticism, that people come onto my channel and criticize me, that my friends and family keep me in check, that I keep myself in check, and that I remind you guys every day I'm way too lazy to run a cult. Please do not see me that way. What I want to be seen as is a person who has discovered something, has talked about it, has shared it because it's helped her. But I know that it's not going to help everybody. It's just going to help some people. But those some people could be looking for that thing. And I just want to present it to the world in case it helps them, because it saved me. Like, I can't tell you what it's like being me today versus who I was 2 years ago. Like, the person I am today just, like, wakes up literally every day so happy. And I'm just so blessed by that. Now, I hear Trisha say in her videos, I want to be happy. She even started becoming, like, witchy and doing spells. And you guys know I very much center my existence on the differences between what I know and what I believe. So I don't know that witchiness or tarot or anything like that works, but I incorporate it into my life. But I have no idea if it works. I actually am pretty sure it does, but doesn't. I think it's more of a interaction with the subconscious. And funny enough, the people who are most worried about me running a cult are usually the people who take these things very seriously. So I will say I need people to pay attention to what they actually believe before they judge what I believe, because I think we're just human beings on an earth living in an ecosystem evolved over time. But I don't know that. I just believe it. I don't believe in a God or higher powers. I'm open to it. Don't believe it. So it's like, remember that I'm coming from a perspective of, like, how do I ground people? How did I ground myself? I grounded myself by really examining what was real and then examining myself. So usually when I do one-on-one calls, one of the things some people do is record themselves during our calls, because my consultations are about, like, mentoring people on their spiritual journey / helping them with their life, talking about philosophy, or just shooting the shit and talking about anime. It's up to the caller. but some people do record themselves, and it's very helpful to watch yourself back. Because I'm a YouTuber, I can watch myself, you can watch me, you can watch Trisha, you can watch Island Boys, you can watch Anna. Like, the internet makes it so we are on display constantly, and that can really fuck with your mental health. So the way I keep myself grounded is, like, who is my inner circle? Who can keep me grounded? I just did a podcast with my bestie, Kyoti, and some people were like, I love that when, like, he challenges you and you really like start to like, oh, maybe I am wrong. Yes, because the whole reason I think I got better with my mental health is because I knew I could be wrong and I was wrong. Not all the time, but enough of the time that I needed to sit back and reevaluate my beliefs. Trisha is never going to admit she's wrong in a real way. Anna never admits she's wrong in a real way. Island Boys never admit they're wrong in a real way. Who's the fourth one I kept mentioning? Island Boys, Anna, Trisha. I don't know. But like in my head, sorry, I think the edible is about to hit me. It's hitting me. The point is that I do think moving forward, in order to seek out recovery, one must, like 12 step, acknowledge there is a problem. And I don't think Trisha it will ever do that with a genuine, a guttural belief. Like I feel it. I felt it in my body, yo, when I was in trauma. I was like, something is wrong. I'm doing something wrong. Something is wrong. My therapist, after I had a shitty one, my good therapist, right away, girl, she was like, borderline. I was like, what? Are you sure? She's like, mm-hmm. And then I was like, okay, what do we do now? She goes, what do you want to do now? And I was like, oh, I want to get better. She goes, okay. And then I was like, oh, but I also want to save the world. And she was like, mm-mm, girl. So we talked about it. We went through the steps. We went through why. Why do you want to save the world? Why do you think you're right? Why do you think you're wrong? I remember when I asked her if I should break up with my current partner at the time. She goes, I don't care if you break up with your partner. We need to talk about your joy, though, which is why I promote on this channel very heavily. Seek out your joy. There's no way that Trisha is as joyful as she could be, but I know she's seeking out happiness. You saw, so in conjunction with the live streams where she's being a witch, she also did this video where she was talking about how she's going broke and how the world sees her and how she just wants people to be happy. She wants constant happiness, but happiness is a fluctuating emotion, just like sadness and anger and resentment and pettiness. So joy to me is like an acceptance of your like existence, like being joyful about your life. So the reason I say joy is kind of the goal rather than happiness is because happiness is fluid. Like some days I'm not happy, but I'm always joyful. And I think when you realize the difference between the two, it really radically changes your perception of life and yourself. So I think if I could encourage Trisha to do one thing or anyone like Trisha who's suffering is to remember that happiness is fluid, that you will have days when you're not happy and that's okay, but you could have days in which you are still joyful, grateful for your life. Joyful and grateful, I feel like are the same. Grateful is the foundation for joyful. In order to be joyful, you have to be grateful. I wake up and sometimes I just look at my cat and she's sitting right there in front of me and I'm just like, I am so grateful she came into my life and this makes me so joyful to have her. She's just so a part of my life and I mourn preemptively every day when she might die. Like I'm just like so worried about her all the time. Even though, you know, I understand it's a circle of life and as the great philosopher Mufasa said, like, it's just what it is, homie. Like, it is what it is. So I'm trying very hard to push out a narrative on this channel that you can, when you are online, get a lot of people telling you who you are. And it's your job to build a foundation within yourself of values to know who you are. A lot of people wondered if Trisha was a one. A one on my level system is a completely useless person, guys. Think Jerry from Rick and Morty. Think like a Ted Bundy. Like, they're just kind of useless. Like, they don't produce anything for themselves. They don't move things forward for themselves. They're always self-sabotaging. Take it down to the very individualistic perspective of the self. Useless. Take it to the community's version of the self. Useless. So a one has to be useless in both ways consistently to be a one to me. They have to be useless to the community and useless to the self. Some people going through trauma, some people have disabilities, some people have mental health issues, some people have problems. So they might be really good community members, but be really shitty to themselves. Or they might be really good and efficient for themselves, but really shitty to others. Trisha is a mixture of both, but not quite a one. Trisha is really good at making money and really good at keeping a job. really bad at building sustainability for herself, really bad at investing in herself, but she in some ways invested in herself in order to make the channel. And so that was interesting. But going back to the beginning of this conversation and wrapping it all around, Trisha also did something very fascinating. I'm going to brainstorm with you now, okay? Think about it. So Trisha, mentally ill and crazy on her kitchen floor, gets her views and fame and association with a bunch of YouTubers. Trisha, as she gets better and healthier, i.e. through the interaction with Ethan and Hila, becomes stable enough to lose viewers, freaks out, causes drama, gets triggered, has moments, views go up, views go down, views go up, views go down. Now, after the whole frenemies thing, Trisha is trying to make decisions where she is being strategic with her posting, right? She's really trying to put out wholesome content. She put out a couple of crying videos, but then deleted them or privated them. She is attempting to like not be that person, but in doing so, the consequence has been a lack of views. Honestly, like her views are way, way down in comparison. I mean, a big part of that as well is the saturation of the internet. There's a lot of other crazy people for people to watch. So Trisha might be the listener least entertaining at the moment. Like Renicado Avocado is getting like that same attention. Eugenia Cooney is getting the same attention. Lots of YouTubers use it for that attention. I think that's what my stalker tried to do as well. That's what I think Anna is trying to do. I think it's like a version of narcissism that is just insane for some of them, or just like a spectrum of narcissism and NPD. But I think in particular, it's amazing to watch people self-sabotage in such a poetic and distinct way that a part of you just feels like you're being gaslit talking to them or watching them, but they're not doing it maliciously. Like they're not even smart enough to intentionally gaslight you. I think they're kind of a mixture of dumb and narcissistic or big egos. Mental health is a very confusing spectrum. It's very hard for me to process the idea that Trisha is smart enough to convince us she's always real, but we know she's not because she gets caught in lies. But then you look at HRH, Her Royal Highness, and everyone told me to watch her, and then her viewers came on my channel and went crazy in defense of her. She's a real person. She's a real person. But then the same people that were rooting for her were like, oh, but she has a huge like drug issue, or she has mental health issues, and that's why she's crazy. Look, the way I'm talking to you, the way people have conversations, the tone, the canter, everything, like I pay attention to all those things in conjunction to know how introspective of a person I'm talking to. One of the things I've realized listening to Mr. Girl and Destiny is like Mr. Girl is introspective, but almost like on a spectrum in a sense. Like he wants to be closer to Destiny, but Destiny has a wall up. But Destiny also perceives himself as super authentic, which he is to the extent he can be without letting his wall down in order to be hurt, quote unquote. But then Mr. Girl wants authenticity and intimacy with Destiny, so he doesn't understand the social awkwardness of wanting and desiring that, right? Past, you know, by pushing it. He wants to do it by just stating it. I want to be close and intimate with you. And Destiny's like, well, those things happen over time. And like, they're not understanding that, right? But I don't think Mr. Girl is like Anna or she's like Trisha. Mr. Girl is reliable, but not safe in the sense that because he lacks the social awareness, it makes him less safe to like put your kid in their care or to put my life in their care, because they're not going to make the same decisions a socially aware and smart person would make. Do you know what I'm saying? It's funny. One of the funny parts about my family is like, so we have nieces and nephews, and my brother is very, very, very particular about who gets to take care of his kids. And he lets me take care of the kids. Like they come over 3 nights a week. They're coming over tonight, and I take care of them. It's 5-year-old, 3-year-old, and like a 1.5-year-old, and they're fantastic. 2 boys, 1 girl. Just they love coming here. I love them being here. It's my favorite thing in the whole world, right? And I asked him, I was like, what's it like having like your borderline gay sister like take care of the kids? And he's like, honestly, dude, like you're the most reliable. And that's because I've overcome the mental illness. That's because he knows my queerness isn't a threat to his kids. He knows I'm not going to sit there and be like, Catholic Church is evil, be gay. Like that's not something I'm going to do. I respect their religion. When they're over, we pray before like snacks and stuff, because that's how they function within their culture. Like or their religion. So what I mean to say is, it's not that you're sick that people don't trust you. It's that you are sick and don't believe you're sick that makes you scary to deal with. So when I see Anna talk to Destiny and she's just like in complete denial that she's sick other than depression and anxiety, it frustrates me because then I'm like, then you're stupid. And she's like, I'm not stupid. I'm in school to be a psychologist. And I'm like, then you're manipulative. I'm not manipulative. Then you're sick. I'm not sick. Oh my God. There's only so many options. When I look at Trisha, I see a sick person. I see a little girl. I see a woman who's trying. I see someone who's playing fantasy. You guys know that I want to be a mom more than anything, that I'm looking into adoption and all of these things that coincide with my value system. Trisha is on this journey of having a baby. Now, the issue isn't that people with borderline or people with a mental health issue aren't getting or are having babies. The issue isn't that like sick people have babies. The problem is like when sick people who don't have a handle on their mental illness have babies, the babies suffer. So I, as a mentally ill person, though in recovery, would like to be a responsible parent in the way that I know I can be because I'm smart and I would wait to have a child. You know, I want to make sure my house is bought. I want to make sure that's the only debt I have. I want to make sure that I'm in a space to like get ready to have the like family around me to make sure that, like, there's like some help with this kid, make sure I can hire a nanny. And I'm going to do this all by myself. And I make very few monies in comparison to like a Trisha. But Trisha's doing something that I think is making a lot of us nervous, which is being in a position of power where she has access to information and remaining stagnant in that education. And therefore running a path of like deciding to have a baby when they have little to no support from their family and friends, when they have burned the bridges with their family and friends, mother-in-laws, people that could be a really good presence for that child. She's also forgetting she hasn't gotten a handle on her own mental illness. And though she's trying, she has a partner who's encouraging this baby-making thing, maybe hoping she can't get pregnant, maybe hoping she can, in a way that makes me think they both have a very low introspection level, but they're not completely useless as ones because they've both managed their life. They both are helpful to some people. A lot of people feel really helped by Trisha. A lot of people feel really helped by Moses. So we can't say that they haven't formed communities. I just wouldn't be surprised if they weren't the healthiest of communities. And so when I look at her and I look at her decision making, I have to say to myself, if you were more introspective, you wouldn't have this baby until you were better. You know, I meet people all the time who are in academia. I meet people, other female feministy types or / independent women who will always like criticize what I do for a living because like, oh, you think you're this great philosopher. And I was like, no, I think I'm very like Socratesian in a way, like I know nothing. And I think we don't want to accept that. I think the ego is so big in the world that me saying we don't know nothing makes people feel like she's lying because she is smart. I am smart, but I'm smart enough to know that I'm not that smart. You know what I'm saying? Trisha isn't even smart enough to know she's not that smart because in her bubble, like the island boys, that is what smart is. In my bubble, that's just what luck looks like and hard work. Not smarts. Not smart in the way that counts. When I think of who is smart, I think about who has organized their life and learned their life lessons and not repeated mistakes. When I think of what intelligence is, it is literally like, are you smart enough? Can you process what like generational trauma is, if you use that word in your vocabulary, which Trisha uses a lot of words she doesn't know. I actually have this great theory about narcs, which is I think everyone's theory on the internet, that like they literally go to therapy. You know, I believe this theory that they go to therapy to learn the terms to like use it to gaslight people. I think that's pretty common. I deal with a lot of borderlines. I talk to people with borderline all the time and they are not quite the same flavor as like a Trisha or an Anna who like when faced with the literal truth will lie every 15 seconds, different truth, flip-flop, in the same conversation. It's very different than a boy, like island boys, who's stubborn and they buckle down and they go, I'm doubling down, like Fresh and Fit. I wouldn't say Fresh and Fit have NPD. I would say they're definitely narcissistic, high on the narcissistic scale, but they're not narcissists. I think instead what they are is undereducated men who are one percenters or made lots of money at least. I don't know if they're one percenters, but they make a lot of money. I have to assume they're one percenters. They make a lot of money and they're big fish in their small pond. So they have like the perfect storm of thinking I have discovered the answers. But that's why I'm saying like introspection will humble you. You'll feel gratitude and they're joyful because you'll be so grateful for what you have when you really get pulled out of your bubbles and you get humbled. It is such a unique experience, but you can't get humbled by being bullied. So the internet's not a good place to get humbled, not really. And then you can't get humbled unless you're open to being wrong. So right now with Trisha, what I'm seeing is a lack of wanting to be wrong, but also she'll say she's open to being wrong. And she will change her ways, but she won't do it because you said it. She'll do it because she wants to do it. So that's very like strategic. And I have seen Trisha avoid some of her past mistakes. Like I think about just like crying Trisha on the kitchen floor versus this Trisha. Obviously, she knows that posting crying videos is not going to help her cause. She posts some of them, but they're not to the extent they were before, guys. Like, we have to give credit where credit is due. The girl has learned. So in that way, she's not a one to me. Like, she learned just that much to know better. Versus when I interact with ones, it's like they, like I said, they just don't know how to be helpful to the community. To build bridges, and they can't build bridges with themselves. So they're self-sabotaging in such a perfect storm way that it's like you can't even have a conversation that's worth having with them. They just won't get it. But a two will hear enough to change, even if they don't give you the credit, which is what Trisha does. So major props to Trisha and major props to the internet for like slowly moving past Trisha. I think it's that time for me as well. I think I'm ready to unsubscribe and to thank Trisha for the last decade of entertainment and introspection. To thank Trisha for the work that she's done by putting herself out there and spending her money how she wants. I hope in this process she does not go broke for real. I hope in this process she really manages her income. I hope in this process she gets better mental health, you know, access. I hope in this process that she ends up joyful. And she gets that balance between being happy and being joyful in her life. I want the best for her because obviously if the world was better, the world wouldn't be so chaotic. But it's a process. And I can't judge where she is on her journey. But I can, you know, be open but have boundaries. So I'm going to remain open to Trisha. But I'm going to close the gate in front of my house. The white picket fence I have, I'm going to close it. Kick her out. Thank you for this time in my life. But you are no longer helping me on my own introspection journey. And I can no longer watch you self-sabotage so continually, even though you're getting better, you're moving at a pace that it's slower than it should be given your resources, girl. You have the money. Stop buying cars. Go get a good therapist. I'm telling you, it will change your life. And let me reassure you, Trisha, if you see this, after you recover and when you get better, being joyful every day beats being happy every day. 10 out of 10. I'm telling you right now, when you really feel good in your body and you settle into your life, girl, things will make a lot more sense. And I promise you it's going to be difficult, but if you really move through it, it will be worth it. And you won't be sick anymore in the way that you were before. You'll absolutely know when you're triggered. You'll absolutely be able to like function in a real way and then have relationships in a real way, which I want for you and I think you want too. But don't let me push my dream onto you, girl. You know, be strong. Anyways, thank you for watching, guys. If you have comments or questions, leave them down in the sections below. Remember, I'm not a therapist. That's not my job. I'm in the philosophy realm of the world. I'm here as like an introspective journey, spiritual person who's trying to help you understand like life is a balance of knowing what's mentally wrong with you, physically wrong with you, and spiritually wrong with you. You got to have all of them. And if you don't, you're going to run into like... just, you know, sorry for the Middle Eastern goodbye. I keep going. But like, you're going to run into that constant cycle and wonder, why am I here again? You're here again because you're not learning your life lessons. So you have to learn the lesson, process it, and move forward. And trust me, as somebody who works with people, I work with people with money. I work with people with no money. What I'm here to teach you is not about money. It is about understanding and it's about forgiving yourself and giving yourself time to grow. You know what I mean? You don't have to have thousands of billions of dollars. You can do this with no monies. You just have to be able to move forward. And that takes discipline. And trust me, if you have discipline, you'll have money. That it's a cycle. It's a whole circle. I promise you, being a whole human being, guys, mental health, spiritual health, physical health, financial health. And of course, what is your trope? Who are you in the anime? Trisha's the beautiful, hot mess, mentally ill girl who like somehow managed to make money off of it, but is still lonely and feeling shallow. I understand it, girl. I get it. I'm a YouTuber too. I might be small, but I know that the pressures are there. That's why you have to find your inner circle, ride or die, and that's why you have to be disciplined. So when the world tries to tell you who you are, you can remind the world, no, I did the work. I know who I am. I'm working on it. I'm not perfect. I'm working on it. Nobody is perfect, Trisha. Nobody. Nobody. Okay? I wish you the best of luck. I wish everyone the best of luck on their journey. If you guys have comments or questions, leave them down in the sections below. And I, let me make sure I'm done. We'll see you Friday for the live shows, Mondays for live shows, and Wednesdays for the podcast. See you guys then. Bye.
Holy cow, that's crazy.
Stuck in my head in real life I'm in bed. My belly's being fed and I'm okay. I'm just fine, yet all I do is whine. Not to you in my mind, cause I know I don't make sense. I've been nothing but blessed. So why's my life a mess? Please tell me, cause I'm sick of thinking. Yeah, I'm sick of reaching out for the truth and living life as a fool. Dun, da, 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 da,